not be able to put on my camera for some reason, but that's okay.
So thank you very much. It's a great honor for me to introduce Dr. Shannon Odell. Dr. Shannon Odell is a lecturer in interdisciplinary palliative care and medicine. And she's going to talk today about a very important topic, something we see on a daily basis on the wards, is the withholding and withdrawing of life-sustaining therapies. Dr. Odell is really qualified to talk about this project. She is both a palliative care doctor in the private sector. She also has a master's degree in palliative medicine and a master's degree in bioethics. And she also is part of a board member of PALPRAC. So thank you very much, Dr. Odell, for presenting on this topic. Thank you.
Super. Thank you very much. Hello, everyone. It's great to be with you, and thank you for joining this lunchtime meeting. I'm just having a little technical hitch in that I can't see my actual PowerPoint myself. Can anyone give me clues on how I can get to?
We can see it.
Is it? Yeah, it's weird that I can't see it.
It just needs to get started. It's on the normal PowerPoint page. So you're going to just have to ask it to start the PowerPoint. You should be able to access PowerPoint on your status bar at the bottom if you're on a Windows device or as an open app on Apple.
Maybe it's on apps.
You can just say slideshow, start from the beginning.
Okay, I'm going to stop sharing and then try again. But while I'm trying to do that, I'm going to just give you some background as to why the title of my talk is Withholding and Withdrawing Life-Sustaining Therapies. I'm going to try and explain during this talk some of the ethical rationales behind these difficult clinical situations where we as healthcare providers might refrain from doing whatever is technically possible for patients, particularly near the end of life. So a logical place to start would be to consider what is life-sustaining therapy. And the description itself confers the intention of the therapy, that is to continue or to preserve life and to sustain life. And this, I'm hoping I'm going to get to my slides now. The slide that I want to show you is that one. Can you see the second slide?
No, they're not moving. We're still on the first slide. There we go.
All right, the next slide. There we go. You with me? All right, so in this slide, you can see some of the measures that we might consider giving to a patient. We might provide antibiotics, chemotherapy, ventilation, dialysis, even CPR. And I've got another picture up here of artificial nutrition and hydration. So there are perhaps various levels of intervention that we might consider for life-sustaining therapies, maybe a basic sustenance, your nutrition and hydration, and then more invasive procedures. And these measures reflect the advances in medical science and our programming to try and continue to try all measures to save and sustain someone's life. And not doing such would be tantamount to our failure, maybe even to giving up on patients, and to be accused by some of letting them die or killing patients. So society expects healthcare professionals to be aggressive in doing good, to have the answers, to know the cure, to work the miracles, no matter what or when, so even at life's end. And this can lead to immense moral distress. However, some of that pressure, if we're honest, is actually internally driven, perhaps personally, but also professionally and within institutional culture, as well as obviously our fear of medical legal litigation. But the old adage rings true. Just because we can sustain and prolong life doesn't mean that we should. So when shouldn't we? When do we reconsider and reevaluate our goals of care for the patient, our intent in intervening, and even to withhold or withdraw treatment? When do we agree on such a definitive course of action that would no longer sustain life, but may seem to actually allow or to hasten death? Is it something that we judge intuitively or after consensus, or are we directed by institutional policy, or even just when the money stops? And how can these decisions with these outcomes be considered ethical? The Health Professions Council of South Africa has recently published its guidelines for the withholding and withdrawing of treatment. And they say that if they want to provide an ethical framework of good practice for health practitioners in circumstances where they are faced with making a decision on whether to withhold or withdraw life prolonging treatment, it is based on these areas of broad consensus, so they don't tell us exactly how and why or where that took place. So broad consensus so far established and recognizes the need to ensure that patients can die with dignity and that their families and others close to them are appropriately involved in their care. So throughout my presentation, I'm going to put the quotes from the HPCSA in the little blue block, and I've used literally copy and paste. This is how they find it, except for the highlighting and the bold font, which is my own. So here it's describing the shift in our endeavors of a heroic life prolongation to allowing the patient to die with dignity. And the HPCSA confirms that these considerations are still within the realm of caring for the patient and also their family. And thus withholding and withdrawal of treatment never implies abandoning the patient and his or her care. The guidelines allude to important ethical considerations in answering my earlier question of when should withholding and withdrawal be considered in a patient's trajectory. It mentions quality of life, and it mentions best interest considerations, which point to the potential benefit the treatment offers the particular patient. Thus, when a treatment is no longer of benefit to the patient, then withholding and withdrawing needs to be considered. So the HPCSA recognizes that discussions about the possibility of withholding and withdrawing are difficult and distressing, sometimes for us, sometimes, you know, for the patient as well. However, this does not mean that such discussions should be avoided. Instead, the discussion should be handled sensitively and with appropriate support being provided to the patient. Health practitioners should also consult with those close to the patient about the best means of withholding or withdrawing treatment where this is appropriate. Now, I'm not sure what the HPCSA means by the best means. Are they alluding to the timing of the withdrawal? Are they alluding to where the patient should be when we consider withdrawal? But the gist of it, I think, is that the patient and the proxy should be involved in the decision making regarding withholding and withdrawal. So when should goals of care discussions take place? Knowing that communication and consensus making is a prelude to the actual event, it is a prelude to the withholding and withdrawal. And these type of dialogues and discussions obviously encourage collaboration and shared decision making. And importantly, they try and alleviate and ameliorate any divisive or adversarial debate when we are considering where the therapy is futile. So the goals of care discussion ideally should take place at the start of the doctor-patient relationship. So just like consent, obtaining consent is an iterative process, so too this goals of care discussion. Ideally, it should start at the beginning of the relationship, at the time of a new diagnosis, prior to starting a new therapy. I mean, that's obvious. And obviously as well at the time of disease progression or recurrence, or when side effects pop up, or when we establish or when we realize that actually there's a disparity between what the patient is hoping for, their expectations, and what a reasonable outcome we think might be hoped for. So again, to summarize so far, we need to consider that death is not a failure on our part. It is a natural process and part of life. And if that is the case, then our goals of medicine also need to be evaluated, our goals of care, so that it extends beyond just trying to prevent untimely death and prolong life. And we need to consider what that might be for our particular patient at that particular time. can you see that the goals of care and the goals of medicine might extend to actually, you know, obviously trying maybe for successful treatment, or it might be returning the patient to a semblance of normal life, for them to gain more autonomy, to control their symptoms, to improve their function, improve their quality of life. And you know, we need to think how subjective those things are. We might want to just purely help them in their ability to interact with the surrounding environment, to reduce suffering, or even preparing the patient for a peaceful death is a goal of care that is valid, is absolutely valid. So those shifts in our goal of care show our intent in thinking about prescribing a particular goal, a particular treatment or intervention. And when we have intent, it speaks to our care plan. How are we going to accomplish that? So our obligations, our care plan also speaks to our obligations to the patient, to the family, and to the medical institution, as well as with us reflecting on what our responsibilities are in terms of resource management and social justice. So if I can just emphasize, the intent needs to be reflected in the care plan. All right, I'm just trying to get to the next slide. Okay, so I've set the goal of care for the, we then decide on our medical treatment or procedure or even the investigation that we consider. And there are certain prerequisites for considering that in the light of our intent and the new goals of care that we've established. Number one is that the treatment or procedure should be medically indicated, i.e., you know, for the particular patient at that particular time, according to the diagnosis, and obviously we're presuming that the diagnosis is correct. The second thing is that consent has been obtained from the patient or the proxy. So here we've got the ethical principles coming out of beneficence and obviously patient's autonomy as well. So in my little block for prerequisites, we've got indication and consent. And when I'm talking about indication, we've said again, it's your intention, your goal of care. And we cannot achieve desirable outcomes if the goal is not established accurately or the means for achieving the goal are not selected carefully. All right, so you don't want to, you know, start by failing. So subsequently, a failure to achieve a certain goal shouldn't be interpreted as it being futile or worthless. Okay, healthcare practitioners also need to differentiate between a treatment which produces an effect limited to one aspect of physiology compared with a benefit which improves the patient as a whole. So if a treatment produces an effect but fails to provide a benefit, it may be deemed as futile. The HPCSA guidelines stipulate that the healthcare practitioner shall refrain from employing unusual methods of treatment which are of no benefit to the patient. So I hope that there is a nagging question that you're asking yourself. Who decides on whether there is a benefit? And who has the competence to determine the usefulness and the fruitfulness of a intervention or an investigation? So at this point, I would like to spend a little bit of time considering the definition of futility. And I apologize that I'm speaking so fast, but there's a lot of things that I want to cover. In our lay language, we might consider futility as being something that is useless, it's not worth pursuing, it's worthless, it adds zero benefits. And obviously those have negative connotations when we're actually speaking to patients and families, but I want us to still continue using the term futility when we're discussing the principles and things like that. But perhaps to consider, instead of using futility, to say an intervention might be considered medically inappropriate or perhaps no longer beneficial when you're talking to patients and family. It has less of a negative connotation. And considering futility will assist in our decision making regarding withholding and withdrawing treatments. Remember that futility decisions are in regard to the worth of the treatment, with respect to the goal of care, not the worth of the patient. Okay, so literature describes medical futility as either being physiological, as being quantitative or qualitative. Physiological futility is defined really as treatments that are incapable of or do not produce or help achieve the intended physiological effect. So the classic example is that if someone has a viral infection, prescribing an antibiotic will not influence the longevity of the viral infection. It has no effect. Okay. But similarly, performing CPR on a decapitated person or someone with rigor mortis, that action is of no value. It is worthless. It is useless in trying to save the person's life, which would be the goal of care. So we have physiological futility, which is quite objective, and that one is sort of easy to understand. The next one is quantitative futility. And this one, we presume, is when the healthcare professional, the treating team, through their personal experience or their experiences with other colleagues, or looking at the published empirical data or various scoring systems, maybe even, that they consider the intended medical treatment to be useless in producing the physiological effects of the stated goals of care, or that the benefit is seen to be exceedingly poor. And obviously here, quantitative, we're referring to the success rate of a treatment. Now, I hope again, you're asking yourself, what qualifies as a success? What percentage could we consider to be success? Does that percentage change potentially for a patient? So let's park that idea. The Health Professions Council of South Africa says that we need to identify appropriate options that are based on up-to-date clinical evidence, which I've mentioned, and that we must reach a considered judgment on the likely benefits, burdens, and risks for the particular patient for that treatment at that point in time. And if you don't have that experience, you need to consult a practitioner who has relevant experience in that field. And if you're in doubt, always to consult. HPCSA suggests that if you don't have experience maybe in palliative care, that you consult a practitioner with relevant experience, particularly when considering withholding or withdrawing artificial nutrition and hydration. And they also say that consider consulting a practitioner, getting a second opinion when there's a serious difference of opinion between health practitioner and patient. So what percentage would you consider as being, you know, a success of the treatment? Your 3% might mean something very different to my 3%. And in those instances, you know, to get a second opinion. So quantitative, we think it's going to be nice and clear cut, but often it isn't. Qualitative medical futility is more subjective, obviously, and is also more controversial. So it refers to an intervention that, even if successful, will result in an outcome that might be insufficient or unacceptable in terms of the functional status of the patient. So there's a value judgment there. It points to the value of achieving a certain goal. All right. And it requires the knowledge of the patient's and family's values and beliefs to decide upon continuation or discontinuation of a treatment. So some may argue that where continued biologic life without conscious autonomy occurs, or if the patient cannot achieve any life goals except for just continued physiological survival, as in they're in a persistent vegetative state, an intervention should be considered qualitatively futile. And again, I hope your little red buzzes and you're asking yourself, but how do we establish that? Being able, if someone's disabled, they might still, you know, be okay with being bed bound, but they might want to have different goals of care. And we can't obviously impose our goals and our values onto the patient. So we need to give priority to the patient. We need to have the best use of resources. And very importantly, we mustn't allow our own views to affect or prejudice our choice of treatment, and we must consider the general standard of care. All right. So coming back to the prerequisites of pursuing a treatment or intervention, we've spoken about that the indication should be of benefit to the patient and should not be considered futile. And the second thing is that the patient must give consent. I'm not going to spend a huge amount of time on this, but we know that patients are competent to give informed consent if they have capacity to understand, they're able to retain and weigh up the information, and they're then able to clearly communicate their choice. The HPCSA says specifically that health practitioners should bear in mind that the decisions of competent adult patients to refuse a particular medical intervention must be respected, even where this would result in serious harm to them or in their own death, unless the patient's state of mind is such that he or she is incapable. So, you know, if the patient is depressed, are they competent, and have that fully evaluated by a psychiatrist. But if a patient does not give consent, then we cannot pursue that intervention. If the patient is not deemed to be competent, then we look to see if there was a pre-existing living will or advanced directive. And the HPCSA gives nice definitions of what a directive is. And that's when a competent individual patient has given an indication of what they would prefer and not want done when they become incompetent. It also describes a patient-selected proxy, and it speaks about the best interests of the patient. So we consider the living will, which is not a legal document, but we consider it and in the light of whether it's in the best interests of the patient, which means that the health practitioner takes certain steps or follows certain rules so that the patient is prevented from unnecessary harm and unduly suffering. So we're always looking, is there harm, basically, that this might produce on the patient? And we weigh that against what their pre-existing preferences were. But if there's no living will, then I've said there would be a patient-selected proxy decision maker. And in the HPCSA, they talk about that we might even consider close family as being able to give or make a decision on the patient's behalf. Interestingly, in the new guidelines, as opposed to the previous ones, they define a close family member also to include any other person who shares the same household with the individual. So that's interesting, an interesting inclusion, and we can discuss that at some point. So coming back, the prerequisites for any medical treatment, we've said, are that there should be an indication and that there should be consent. So what if there is an indication and there's no consent? I've said that the healthcare practitioner cannot override the refusal of a competent patient because they would then be liable in battery. You cannot provide physical contact. It is against the integrity of the person and it is unlawful. So even if, like I said, the patient's refusal of the treatment might result in his or her death, for example, they do not consent to the initiation of ventilation, we cannot proceed if that patient has been fully informed, is capable of making the decision, knows the consequences, knows that it might result in their death. If they still, knowing all of that, refuse the treatment, we cannot override that. We cannot proceed with the intervention. But what if the patient is not giving consent or refusing the treatment because they're wishing to commit suicide? Okay. And unfortunately, that HPCSA does not give any guidelines to that effect. The closest I could find in the HPCS guidelines were that where significant disagreement arises about a patient's best interest, health practitioners should seek a clinical and an ethical review independent of the healthcare team. If this fails to resolve the disagreement, they must seek legal advice. So I think when it's not clear, when, if the patient is depressed, we might consider them as incapable or not having medical decision capacity. But what if they're not depressed and could be considered competent to make the decision of refusing the treatment in order to end their life prematurely? I think we have to go, the decision has to be made under review. And again, when I say under review, we have to consider that all these decisions that I'm talking about are ideally not made in haste. We need time to consider these carefully and ethically. What about the situation where the indication for the treatment is a little bit iffy, and the patient is requesting it? And in this circumstance, the intervention is maybe beneficial to the patient according to their value system, but might not be physiologically effective. And the examples that I'm thinking here are, for example, if a family member of a patient with brain death asks that a completely ineffective traditional medicine is administered to the patient, because that might help the patient's family members feel that they've done their best in order to save their patient's life. Should we consider that? And I have a feeling that compassionately, yes, we should indicate it for a period of time. In another circumstance, perhaps a patient asks for in vitro fertilization, despite knowing its ineffectiveness for her. And similarly, such a request gives her the lifelong feeling that she has not disregarded any and every endeavor to have a baby. So in some instances, it may be appropriate to continue temporarily to make a futile intervention available to assist the patient or family in coming to terms with the gravity of their situation and in reaching closure. Okay. However, futile intervention should not be used for the benefit of family members if this is likely to cause the patient substantial suffering. So again, we're coming across to the best interests of the patient, and we shouldn't pursue this if the family's interests are clearly at odds with those of the patient. Okay. So I've mentioned a trial of treatment, and a trial of treatment would be any intervention that is ongoing or planned. It should be framed and in discussion with the patient and their family as a trial of treatment, is that we're going to have ongoing reconsideration and we're going to journey through this. It's an iterative process. So when we have a structured time-limited approach, we agree upon a set period of time when we then are going to reassess what are our goals of care. Are we able to achieve our goals of care with continuing this treatment, or do we need to consider that withdrawal of this treatment is in the best interest of the patient? So it's about deciding in advance, about lessening the emotional context of the decision making, and it's setting sort of the goals of care very explicitly, that we are not wanting to continue non-beneficial care. And this is obviously very important in a medical ICU. Now, the one thing that doesn't, you can't have a trial of treatment for is if the patient requests euthanasia or medical assistance in dying. And what do we do if the euthanasia or the killing of the patient, the intentional hastening of death of the patient, does not qualify for our goals of care, but they still give consent to that? So we must always consider that withholding and withdrawing of treatment is not equivalent to euthanasia or medical assistance in dying, because there the goal of care is to end the patient's life. And the intent, which is followed through in the care plan, is that we're intending to kill the patient. All right, so that's very different to considering a treatment to be futile and therefore considering withholding and withdrawing treatment. So that's the main difference between withdrawal and euthanasia, is the intent of the healthcare practitioner. The HPCSA clearly says that it takes account of existing law in this area, that allowing for withholding and withdrawing of life-sustaining treatments, and that which prohibits killing, active euthanasia, and assisted suicide. It is based on the premise that any medical intervention where the health practitioner's primary intention is to intend the patient's life is contrary to the ethics of healthcare, and it is unlawful. Okay, so that is stated as it is in the newly revised guidelines. The guidelines define withholding life-sustaining treatment as a process by which medical interventions are refused or denied, and that is either refused by the patient or denied by the healthcare team, with the understanding that the patient will most probably experience natural death from the underlying disease or related complications. So there's that distancing in that definition, that the intent is not to hasten the patient's death, but that by withholding a futile treatment, we can no longer successfully get the outcome of continuing life at all costs, of staying off death, but that our goals of care have changed, and that allowing a natural death that be comfortable, that there'd be no distress, that it would be peaceful, those are the new goals of care. Likewise, the definition for withdrawal of life-sustaining treatment is that these interventions are ceased or discontinued, with the understanding, again, that the patient will most probably experience natural death from the underlying disease or related complications. So it comes again to our recognition that death is a natural process. Okay. So coming back to the consent issue, we've said that we can't continue an intervention if the patient doesn't give our consent. But where the indication is not clear, that it's not defined, but the directive, the advanced care directive that the patient or the proxy has specified, says that the patient should continue this specific treatment. That directive cannot compel the healthcare team to provide treatments that lie outside acceptable standards of care, nor may it direct a proxy to do so. So again, the concept of standards of care come into being, and we need to think, where are those standards of care written? Where is that textbook? Are there always standards of care documentation? And I think in the palliative care sense, we are continually looking at how can we formalize and have an acceptable standard of care for our patients. So the health HPCSA guidelines then say that when the patient or the family requests continued treatment against health advice that considers such treatment to be futile, the patient or the family must be given guidance and advice why such decision was taken, and be advised regarding their choice of transferring to another institution where such treatment is available. So I just want to pause there. Do you think that we should be transferring patients when we've considered the treatment that they are after is futile? What does this mean? And they say here that if this option is refused and the health team considers treatment to be futile, and this is confirmed by independent health practitioners, they may nevertheless implement the decision to withhold or withdraw treatment. And in the guidelines, there is a question mark. So, yeah, I think what they are maybe trying to say here is not that we should transfer patients when we consider the treatment to be futile, because if we're considering standards of care, futile here would also be futile there at a different institution, right? But what they are considering here is that if you are, and maybe what they're considering is if you are unable to provide a treatment, then if you're unable to provide it, then you must make plans to transfer the patient, which is also said in the guidelines in another place. But specifically to transfer a patient because they are not accepting of the treatment as being now futile, I don't think that gives qualification to transfer the patient to another facility. I'll come to another point. And I want to ask you as well, or you to consider, should it make a difference if the patients have the ability to pay for futile treatment? And also to consider if the medical aid is willing to reimburse the doctors for providing the futile interventions, is there anything wrong with the doctors offering such treatments? And we see this all the time. So I just want to spend a few minutes on the consequences of providing futile medical treatments. Futile medical treatments that are not beneficial to the patient might cause further suffering for the patient, but they affect the staff as well. They cause suffering on the staff, moral distress, job burnout, job dissatisfaction, and increased turnover among nurses and physicians, and hence, in the long run, decreased quality of care. It also places extremely heavy financial burdens on families, healthcare systems, and societies. A patient in ICU for 3 months often leads to complete bankruptcy of the family. And through that depletion of resources, we're putting other patients at risk. So there's a cost element here, but do you see that it is not the cost that makes the intervention futile? All right. So the HPCSA guidelines state that there are circumstances when withholding treatment, even if it is not in the best interest of the patient, is permissible. Okay, so this is in distinction to the previous comment of futility. So here we're saying that the treatment is not futile. It would be considered valuable and beneficial to the patient. So it is even in the best interest. But the facility providing the treatment is unable to provide for the patient, either because of their policies restricting admission to these units based on national admission criteria, which have been agreed upon by an expert professional body, or that there is inability to provide that same level of treatment, that same standard of care or basic standard of care to all people, so a distributive justice aspect, that they are unable to provide treatment for the patient, even if it is in the best interest. Okay, so particularly here, we're looking at critical care, ICUs, and dialysis units. So a healthcare institution has the right to limit life-sustaining interventions without the consent of a patient or surrogate by restricting admission to these units. But they are obliged to provide the appropriate palliative care and follow up when specialized care is withheld. So this is not a question of futility. I hope that is clear. Our goal of care would always be to try and provide a beneficial treatment to a patient, but even if the treatment would be beneficial, sometimes we're unable to provide it to a patient. And if we can't, they're talking about referring to another institution where such resources exist. So should we consider that there's an overlap between medical futility and rationing? And what is the difference? So in medical futility, I hope I've assured you and convinced you that prescribing X treatment is useless irrespective of the costs. So we don't take cost into consideration, nor do we consider the fair distribution of resources. So distributive justice has no bearing on whether we consider a specific treatment for that specific patient at that point in time futile or not. We do recognize that futile treatments should be avoided, not because of cost, but because they are ineffective in achieving the goals of care. I hope that is very clear as well. And to bring it home is that medical futility decisions are about a particular patient at a particular point in time in their disease trajectory with the knowledge that the treating team has. Okay, as opposed to rationing, where we would think that prescribing X might be useful, okay, but it is inappropriate due to the cost of that treatment, or when other patients' needs for X are also considered. So the treatments which are useful but are expensive should be avoided occasionally because their benefits are not proportionate to the costs. So this is not because that the treatment is futile. The treatment could accomplish the goals of care, but it is disproportionately of no benefit to the greater community in providing only one person with that treatment. Okay, so decisions are made at a community level considering the fair distribution of resources. So there's a difference between medical futility and rationing, and we mustn't say that we're not going to provide, we mustn't consider rationing as a reason for medical futility. And we've spoken about financial things, about costs of things, and I alluded to it a little bit earlier. The HPCSA considers it unethical to continue with life-prolonging treatment for the sole purpose of financial gain. Moreover, it is unacceptable that patients are transferred to state institutions after all their funding has been exhausted as a result of prolonging futile treatments. So I'm sure you have heard from colleagues and had phone calls about this, that this happens all the time in our system. Patients have medical aid, the funds are exhausted, and then they ship through to a government hospital. So we cannot continue futile treatments, exhaust medical aids, and here specifically, we see it in that the goals of care have not been established. It is unethical to continue a futile treatment. And if the patient had been in a private facility, those goals of care conversations have to happen. We can't start having them when things are spiraling out of control, when the money runs out. Okay. The HPCA stipulates the health practitioner should take suitable and prompt action when needed and refer the patient to another practitioner service when this is in the patient's best interests. So we're taking prompt action in having the communication with the patient about the goals of care. Also to do with cost is that we are not obligated to prolong life at all cost. However, it is our responsibility to know when to initiate care and when to cease attempts at prolonging life while ensuring that patients receive appropriate relief from distress. So I hope in my talk, you've been able to maybe consolidate some of your previous thinkings about a treatment being medically futile or inappropriate. Perhaps it is easing your distress, your moral distress, that you're not behoved to continue treatment at all costs. But what I do want to emphasize is that all the time when you're making those decisions, you must be able to justify your decisions and using those sort of rationales that I've tried to describe. But whether you withdraw or withhold, you know, whether you want to nitpick about the difference between withholding and withdrawal, it's not relevant. We must ensure that the patient in front of us has justifiable treatment, that we're looking after their best interests, and that we provide appropriate relief from distress. And here I just want to emphasize again that we need to be providing adequate palliative care when we are considering withholding and withdrawing treatments. Some people may be confused and thinking that the palliative care people should always be considering withholding and withdrawing. And I think it actually needs to come in any team, whether you're in a medical ward, whether you're in ICU, whether you're offering dialysis, whether you're offering CPR, consider the rationale of withholding and withdrawing treatment with the proviso that there would be adequate palliative care being available. So thank you very much for listening. I'm sorry that I've been speaking at the rate of knots. I do want to just leave you with this sort of real mind bender quote that says that there will always be instances where futile treatment works, just as there will always be instances where recommended treatment fails. So maybe that just sort of puts light to things. But thank you for listening. And I just want to also show you my references. I've been able to finish ahead of time, so I'm happy to take questions or to to listen to your comments as well.
Thank you, Shannon. That was really a very insightful and fantastic talk, and the pace was absolutely spot on. So very well received. Thank you. I'm going to ask anybody if they've got any questions. They can put their hands up or otherwise post them in the chat group, and I'll field them during the time that we've got remaining. I've got a question. And, Shannon, what you highlighted was that, I mean, this is a very complex area and very difficult to, as a clinician, to understand what the optimal strategy is at any given point. And you highlighted so many different scenarios. In your experience, is there any country that's doing this optimally or well? And if so, who? And how can we move towards that if that's the case? And what strategies do we need?
Thanks, Jeroen. That is an interesting question. I don't know offhand any particular countries. I know in some countries, for example, they might put policies in place within their hospitals or within their states. I think Texas has such an advanced directive something in place where they need to consider withholding and withdrawing at specific points along the patient's trajectory. So I know that they might consider, considering the goals of care and with medical futility when someone's admitted to an ICU, whether they've stayed X number of days in the ICU. There are sort of control points where they red flag at this point. You need to be considering goals of care. And that's in the ICU setting. I think, and that's the only one that I can think of at the top of my head. I think what we must always be asking ourselves is, yes, we might be achieving physiological improvement, for example, with dialysis, but are we actually having a benefit for the patient? And if that benefit is not tangible for the patient and acceptable to the patient, then we need to be considering, are things medically futile or not? But specific countries, I'm not sure. I think on the whole, often institutions attempt to describe medical futility in particular situations, but I hope it came through in my talk that might be a guide, but always it's about the individual patient. And not everyone will have the same value system, the same demographics, the same extent of illness, et cetera, in order for, policy decisions to be made at the bedside. It is a very nuanced decision making, and it involves the whole team.
Great. Thanks so much for that. And does anybody else have a question that they want to pose? I see there is a in the chat, and I'll read it out. And that was from Judy. She says, great presentation. Shannon, as someone who's working in the community, this is one topic we try hard to address in the communities, particularly one I work in. As we speak, this is one topic I will be addressing with students and care workers. Traditional and religious beliefs really can be challenging in addressing issues such as this. So not really a question, more a comment, but it might open some commentary. But we do have a question. Who's that who's raised their hand? Sorry, it's Willem. Go ahead, Willem.
Good afternoon, everyone. And Shannon, thank you so much for really demystifying this and explaining it so clearly and touching on all the important points. I was wondering if you could provide some commentary on something that we're currently grappling with around making recommendations for out-of-hospital cardiac arrest treatment and understanding that there's a variety of cadre of pre-hospital provider who would be required to make these kinds of decisions. And that, there's added pressure of the family being right there and then. It's an acute event, often, not often, it's always unplanned for. I don't think we plan out of hospital cardiac arrest. And this can create quite a lot of conflict. And thinking about how these providers could potentially be supported in making these kinds of decisions, and how we could, you know, conceptualize what you spoke about now in a context where there isn't a multidisciplinary team, where there isn't necessarily prolonged illness or contact with the healthcare system. But the decision is also time critical because you can't spend even minutes deliberating whether to withhold CPR and resuscitation or otherwise. Thank you.
Thanks, Willem. That's a really, really important question. And I think one of my points was that these decisions should never be made in haste. But in that context, you are in a situation that is time dependent. And the emergency situation is very, very different. Like you said, we have no collateral. Why is the patient collapsed? What are the triggering factors? What are their wishes and their preferences? You know, is there an advanced care directive? And even if there is, you know, it's not a legal document that would prohibit you in performing CPR. So I think, I mean, broadly, we could maybe consider it as starting, I think you'd be hard-pressed not to start resuscitation if you don't have all the facts. I think that it would be hard to justify not starting CPR. Because our goal of care in responding to a collapse or cardiac arrest, our goal of care there is literally, I would presume, is to get the person to more invasive or a more advanced institution to offer more assistance. So your goal of care, I don't think at the community level, is to be considering, you know, the value of this, the percentage of resuscitation efforts being successful in this patient. Oh, he looks like he's 40. Oh, he looks like he's 96 kilograms. We don't know if he's a smoker. So I think there's just too many variables to make an informed decision at the community level. May I ask you, Willem, in that study, what are you considering as your goals of care or your goals of intervention?
Well, I think this is where it becomes, unfortunately, a lot more complex, where this idea of futility and this idea of rationing kind of overlaps. So as you say that there's sort of potentially a requirement or an idea that we're going to have more invasive procedures. So maybe like take the patient to PCI or similar, because that's sort of the, I would say, quote unquote, definitive treatment for a cardiac arrest of presumably of ischemic origin. Now, in the context where these kinds of interventions are not available to most patients, is that decision then at that point a decision of rationing and understanding that we cannot carry through the final goal of care, which would be probably ICU stay and PCI, or is it a question of futility because of the series of prognostic factors that we're taking into consideration? So that's sort of where the thinking lives a little bit. And what complicates it even more is there's this sort of geospatial layer over that speaks about how far are you from the ambulance and how far are you from the facility that could potentially do some stuff. So I think I'm really just trying to maybe initiate a conversation of an opportunity where, you know, we could explore this a little bit more. And from qualitative work that we've looked at, you know, providers are making these decisions on these system questions and also on these sort of more clinical indicators. So it's really hard to come up with, for me actually, to come up with a very definitive answer of how to solve this problem going forward.
Yeah, sure. It is very, very complex. And I think my only sort of thinking would be to divide up the various stages of the decision making into various goals of care chunks. So if the initial responder's goal of care is to resuscitate, stabilize, and be able to transfer the patient, then at the emergency unit, the goal of care would then be to determine what, are we going to try and relieve the, are we going to stent? Are we going to, so you're breaking it up into separate points, because I think it's really unfair for someone responding to make the overall judgment for that whole procedure. And I get your point about rationing. It is very difficult. I don't think that we must use the concept of rationing to consider that a treatment is futile. I think that is, they are very separate things, because that patient would benefit from X, Y, and Z, but for the lack of resources. But it's, it's tricky.
No, that's very helpful. I like the idea of thinking about where each goal lives. And then once you've established that, you can actually start teasing out the guidelines or the guidance that you can provide to the system, if that is sort of the way that you're thinking through it. And then we can add all the complexity so that, and I agree, it's very unfair for a provider to have to be able to make that decision right there. I think that's why it's important that we need to think about, providing that guidance and thinking through these problems together.
Yeah, absolutely. But I think that dividing a trajectory of the patient or the patient's course of treatment into various, goals of care, and making sure that you at various points in that trajectory, you are considering the goal of care and you are reconsidering why you're doing what you're doing. Is it worth, are we likely to achieve our goals of care by continuing this treatment? I think that's also a very important aspect to get across.
Great, thank you so much, appreciate it.
Thanks, Willem, for the question. I think that we don't have any further questions in the chat, and no one's got their hand up. So I think that brings us just on the hour to the end of the talk. So thank you so much, Shannon, for that great talk. And thanks everybody
who
attended.
Thank you very much.
Certainly has prompted a lot of thought, and it's clear that your division has so much more to contribute and such a long road still to travel in terms of where we need to be compared to where we are, which is great, and lots of work to be done in the future. So thank you everybody for attending, and till the next seminar.
Super. Thanks so much, Jerine. Thanks everyone.
Bye-bye.